rich like Killian's. How do we know it's all from that? The light bulb? These magnets. There's a blown up picture of those too. Surf City Pizza. Where's Surf City? You heard one of the witnesses testify. You may know from your own knowledge. It's on LBI. This defendant picked up all this garbage. I submit to you, thinking it'd be linked to him. And he hid it in his garage. For no other reason than to hide what he had done. Now moving forward, there was an autopsy on the 24th. A number of items were submitted to the state police. And John Barcastle was retained to conduct crime scene reconstruction and that blood stain pattern analysis. The DNA. S160A stays circled in red. Those important pieces of evidence. The cigarette butt came back to the victim too. Okay. The defendant bought marble lights that night. They both smoked. Wait a minute. They both smoked. Couldn't that be a reason why Mr. Doody had scope? They want to have a cigarette breath. The victim's blood was found. The victim's DNA was found on the knife blade, on the handle, and on the watch in the defendant's home. It was found on the handle. The defense had suggested to you the only explanation is that Rich Doody held that handle and attacked his friend. Is that the only explanation? What did Teresa Nezazon say? Allison Wayne said she swabbed the handle for epithelial cells. But Teresa Nezazon said she can't know whether she's testing blood or skin. And wouldn't it make sense that the victim's skin was on the handle? Where was that knife used, ladies and gentlemen? Plunged into the victim's throat. It was dragged across his neck. It's a smooth silver handle. We'll talk a little bit more about it in a few minutes, but would that surprise you if there were skin cells from the victim on a knife that was plunged into his throat more than once, dragged across his neck? Is that unreasonable? Does that make more sense? And we know that the defendant's blood was on that light bulb in the trash can in Barnegat Light. He put it there after he killed his friend. The injuries to the victim. Do they disprove this is a killing? No. I submit to you they prove this is a murder. Whether Mr. Sipa picked up one weapon, then a second weapon, then a third, whether he premeditatively had that intent to kill him, that's not the inquiry here, ladies and gentlemen. I submit to you, when he struck his friend over the head, at least causing 10 injuries, I suggest more. At some point, he knew he wasn't dead. That intent to cause him that serious bodily injury or to cause his death, it could have come before he picked up a weapon or during the course of striking him over the head multiple times. At some point, Rich Doody wasn't getting up from that chair. Those injuries to the head with such force, there were not one but two divots to the skull, the second one all the way through to the brain that caused bleeding and minor scope. Why didn't it swell more? Did he live long enough going to? The lamp. Impact spatter on the lamp. Who told you that? Not just the state's expert. Who told you the lamp was a good weapon? The defense expert told you that. Those are her words. laceration into his larynx that caused him to aspirate his own blood. That and that alone was likely the cause of death to Rich Doody. Who held that knife? Did Rich Doody cut his own throat so deeply that it severed his larynx? I submit to you that does not make sense, ladies and gentlemen. The blood evidence. Again. John Garkowski explained it to you. Even without these red lines on S201, I submit to you, you can see for yourselves what this blood evidence tells you. That Rich Doody sat in his chair as blows rained down on his head, and it went further and further down. That's what blood evidence shows, ladies and gentlemen. Not that he was up attacking anyone, provoking anyone. How else do we know? S198 evidence. The impact spatter. S199. On both sleeves of his shirt. John Garkowski said, I submit to you, honestly, he couldn't know if Rich had something in his hands while they were up. But I submit other evidence suggests that's not the case. But what does this show? At some point, his hands are up near the area of impact. Well, what makes more sense? What about that bruise under his left arm? He's left-handed after all. Was he holding a weapon? Or was he sitting in that chair being hit on the left side of his head, and only the left side, with his hands up, and they got in the way? And he got a cut to his finger and some bruising on his left hand because the injuries were to the left side of his head. It's human nature. If you're hit, to put your hands up. What would be up in the air if he was reacting or trying to protect his head? His left arm, where we know he had a substantial bruise. And where he sat in that chair and he bled. And he sat for 6 to 8 hours. And those hand marks, again, I submit, are more consistent. It is a reasonable inference. They are not the fingers. He wasn't bleeding when he was standing. How's he turning? How's he doing anything? He's sitting in that chair, being beaten, bleeding. Where'd the lamp come from? That glass table. Not. And the knife. prongs, matching up to those marks. Is that from a struggle? Or from standing over the chair and inflicting those wounds? The drag marks match up. Did you hear any evidence to contradict this? John Garkowski told you. The victim was beaten with a blunt force object numerous times while seated in the chair. Jan Johnson agreed. The serrated two-prong knife was the weapon used to create the sharp force injury on the victim. Did Jan Johnson disagree? The victim had his hands up near the impact site during a portion of the event. What makes the most sense? He was trying to defend himself. The cast-off patterns indicate that the weapon used to create the injuries was moving from the victim's head to the right. He was struck on the left side of his head, and the weapon was going from the right to the victim's head and back. One weapon failed, he moved on to the next. It's for you to determine whether there is proof beyond reasonable doubt. But when one weapon failed, he then moved on to another. Does that sound in a heat of passion? Or like he wanted to finish the job? So is this self-defense? This is not a case of self-defense, ladies and gentlemen. This is murder. This is not passion provocation. Where is that evidence? If even one of the following factors of passion provocation is not present, it's not a passion provocation manslaughter, just one. This is not some insurmountable burden of proof. It's proof beyond a reasonable doubt that just one of those elements do not exist. There must be adequate provocation. What? What's the provocation? We didn't hear anyone testify. There was yelling and screaming. Because there were knives in a home. Her retired man was by himself most of the time, fishing, cooking. The cats weren't even there anymore. Who cares if there were a kitchen knife here or there? What was the provocation? What evidence have you heard? Actual evidence of any provocation. That it actually impassioned the defendant. It seems like he was angry. Heard to demonstrate. You heard defense counsel say, passion is not proof. I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, there is not proof of passion in this case. Defendant didn't have a reasonable time to cool off between the provocation and the act which caused the victim's death. When one weapon failed, he moved on to another. He didn't have time to cool off. Where do you think a kitchen knife was kept of that size? The lamp broke. He got another weapon. Does that sound like there's no time to cool off? Does that sound like after inflicting multiple blows to the victim's head, like he could possibly have still been coming at him, if that's what you believe, that he was even able to stand at that point? He wasn't dead. So this defendant, when if it's disproportionate to whatever force is being threatened by the victim, the defense fails. Is this proportionate force? Is there any evidence the victim ever held a knife? It requires the defendant has to have a reasonable belief that the use of deadly force was necessary to protect himself against death or serious bodily injury. And he cannot have provoked or incited the use of force, and this use of force is not justified if he knew he could safely have removed himself from the situation. That's what that boils down to. You have those photos and evidence. The defendant was at that house before. We knew he was able to leave sometime around midnight that night. He knew there was another door. Couldn't have just left. Even assuming you believe that story, he couldn't have hit him once and run out the sliding glass door. How is that reasonable, ladies and gentlemen? Self-defense? The victim was the aggressor? Defense talked to you about the cuts and the bruises on the victim's left hand. Jen Johnson was asked about the injuries on the defendant, too. She said those could have been caused by the fire. What else did she say? Those could have been caused by the ceramic lamp all over the place. It's sharp. She offered that explanation on her own. I didn't even have to ask. Could they have been caused by something else? Yeah. They could have been caused by the ceramic lamp all over the place. Makes more sense. He was somehow hitting or doing something with his left hand, or he was sitting in the chair with his hand up when he got hit with the lamp. What about him? He got cut. And he got small bruising that I submit to you can't even see in this photograph. Jen relied on Dr. Hood's conclusion for that one. And we talked about that DNA. Does it make more sense that Rich was holding that one? Or that the DNA was the flow over from the blade or the skin cells from when it was plunged into his neck? What makes more sense? Belligerent. What did Virginia Murray tell you she meant when she used that word? Don't people often use words and not precisely the same way? She said, when I told him to do something, he knew the opposite. That came out in her cross as well. She told you that's what she meant. Remember her tone and her demeanor when she testified. Was she hiding something from you? Did she somehow fabricate an explanation 3.5 years later? Or is that what she meant? Well, he was violent. What other testimony did we have of that? Why this defendant bring such a violent, aggressive friend to 12 packs of beer and a bottle of scotch?